Hi guys, good day. My name is Kenyatta, and it's such a pleasure that you were able to tune in to us today. We are preaching God's word, and I'm excited by it. I'm excited when I get a chance to study God's word. I'm excited when I can deliver God's truth into your hearts, into your living rooms, into your lives. So at this time, why don't you go to Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. This is part 4 of our mini-series, so to speak. Don't worry, seek God. And we started that from the first Sunday in January, speaking about God's will for our lives, which is that we would not worry, that we would seek his kingdom, that we would come under his control, that we would do the right thing. Now, so far in this mini-series, Don't Worry, Seek God, which is part of our Blueprint series, we have seen that anxiety comes when we hoard our treasures. Anxiety comes when we pursue a false vision for life. Anxiety comes when we try to serve and worship two masters. However, freedom from anxiety comes when we are generous with our resources. Freedom comes when we follow the right vision of and for life. And freedom comes when we serve the one true God. Now, I pray that you have been experiencing the freedom and the peace that comes with seeking God. I pray that you would have been putting off the cloak of anxiety, so to speak, and embracing the warmth that comes when you follow and seek God. Okay, let's go to the text right now. It's Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. I'm reading the ESV version, but I need to let you know this, right? There are a ton of other scriptures that I'm going to get into, and I'm going to be reading from the New Living Translation when I get to those scriptures. Don't worry, it's not a heretical translation or anything, but the text, Matthew 6, 25, I'm reading from the English Standard Version. So please read with me as I go. Therefore, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive, which today is alive, and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. What a good word. So here's our first point. Write this down. To be free from anxiety, look at God's generosity. To be free from anxiety, look at God's generosity. And we see that in verses 26 and verses 28 to 30. Now, I know millions and millions of people are going to go to sleep tonight on a comfortable bed with a full stomach and enough clothes to stock a boutique. And yet, they are still racked by anxiety. They're still racked by worry because they're thinking, do I have enough food? Would I have enough food? Do I have enough clothes? Right here in TCI, I was speaking to someone, and last year when we had the pandemic, and we were under lockdown, and we only had certain hours within the day that we can go and shop for groceries. There were some people who, though their cupboards were filled with food and they had enough food to last a month, they still went to the supermarket because they were thinking, I wonder if I have enough food. I wonder if it would last. I wonder if the supermarket would run out of food. People who have it still worry about it. While, on the other hand, there are millions of people who are going to go to sleep tonight without food. They're going to go to sleep tonight on the cold, hard floor because they don't have a comfortable place to lay their head. And they, too, are worried about what they would eat. And they are worried about what they would drink and what they would wear. Now, you may say, you know what? It's wrong for those who have it to worry about it. But there's no way that those who don't have it, those who can't feed themselves, those who don't know where their next meal is coming from, it's okay for them to worry. And that's a mistake we make. Because I believe from this text and the other text that we're going to see, that Jesus is saying to both groups, those who have it and worry about it, and those who don't have it and still worry about it, he's saying to them and he's saying to us, he's saying to me, he's saying to you, don't be anxious about life's necessities. Trust me, because I would provide for you. So whether you have it or don't, it's quite easy for these basic necessities of life, servants of life, so to speak, food, water, clothing, to become masters. I'm going to say that again because I feel that this needs to be said again. It is quite easy for the basic necessities of life, food, clothing, shelter, water, those servants to become masters. So obsessive preoccupation with what you have or don't have is a recipe for anxiety. Obsessive preoccupation with your ability or inability to provide is a recipe for anxiety. Loved one, listen. Life is more than food. Life is more than drink. Life is more than clothing. Your Father provides for the birds. Your Father clothes the flowers, so to speak. So he knows what you need. Now, listen to this. Your Father also says this. Your good, kind, and generous Father in heaven says this. Do not be anxious about what you shall eat, or what you shall drink, or what you shall wear. For Gentiles seek after these things, and your heavenly Father knows you need them all. In other words, Jesus wants us to know that the Father knows what we need, and he will provide for all our needs. Now, to be free from anxiety, you have to trust in God's provision. Now, let's examine how God provides for our needs. And the first way is this. God provides by giving us the means to earn a living. Now, here's what Moses told the Israelites who had just come out of slavery from Egypt. They had gone through the wilderness for close to 40 years. They were just about to enter into the promised land. And in Deuteronomy, Moses is teaching and he's preaching to them, and he's preparing them, he's preparing their hearts for their promised land, the thing that they have been waiting for an entire generation. And this is what Moses says to them in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 7. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land of flowing streams and pools of water with fountains and springs that gush out in the valleys and hills. It is a land of wheat and barley, of grapevines, fig trees and pomegranates, of olive oil and honey. It is a land where food is plentiful and nothing is lacking. It is a land where iron is as common as stone and copper is abundant in the hills. When you have eaten your fill, be sure to praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Now look at that text. As I was reading it, and as I pray as you read it on the screen, do you see how good God is? Do you see how good God was to the Israelites by providing for them? Do you see how amazing and wonderful his provision is? Well, it is the same. He is amazingly and wonderfully generous and will provide all that you need. However, look at how the Israelites, representing mankind, could turn God's goodness into an object of pride. So Moses continues in Deuteronomy 18. Look at verse 12. For when you have become full and prosperous and have built fine homes to live in, and when your flocks and your herds have become very large, and your silver and gold have multiplied along with everything else, be careful. That's what Moses is saying. Be careful. Be careful when you are rich and prosperous and wealthy and everything is going good. Be careful. And he goes on in verse 14. Do not become proud at that time and forget the Lord your God. See what Moses is saying? When you are living the life, when your cupboards are stocked with food, when you have all that you need, be careful. Be careful that you do not forget that it is God who has provided it for you, that God has given you the means by which you can have that. Moses knows the heart of man, and after telling them, this is God's generosity to you, but be careful that your heart doesn't become filled with pride. Now, Moses goes on further to warn them, and he wants them to remember who their source of wealth is. And he wants us to remember who is our source of wealth. So look at what he says, Deuteronomy 18. Look at what he says. This is verse 17. Never say to yourself, I have achieved this wealth with my own strength and energy. How many of us do that? God blesses us with ability. God blesses us with provision. And then we say, it is by my own strength, it is by my own hands that I have achieved this wealth. Verse 18, look at what Moses says. Remember the Lord your God. Etch this on your mind, loved ones. Remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you the power to be successful. He is the one who gives you the power to be successful. As God provides in nature for the birds, as he provides for the animals in nature, in the same fashion he provides for us. But he often does it through things like education. He does it through entrepreneurial brilliance. He does it through a strong work ethic. He does it through networks. He does it through a fruitful land. In other words, God provides the means by which you or I have become wealthy. He provides for us through the means to earn a living. So loved ones, do not in pride walk around telling everybody that your brilliance, your educational brilliance, your marketing genius, that your empire that you built, that all the resources that you have was because of you. Give God praise, because you could lose it in an instant. Give God praise and thank him for giving you the means to earn a living. Here's the second thing. God provides for us through the generosity of others. Now, I believe we do not have a scarcity problem in the world. I believe we have a hoarding problem. God has provided more than enough for every personal life to be fed, clothed, and sheltered. But as a result of greed, A few have more than they will ever need, and they hoard that, while the majority do not have enough. And God calls us, those of us who have it, God calls us to be generous with our resources. And I want to say this before I go on. If you start thinking that it is mine, remember what Moses said in Deuteronomy 18. It is God who gave it to you. It is God who gave you the ability to have it. It's not yours. You're just a steward. You're just a manager. So when you kind of hold it, it's mine and I'm not giving it to anybody. No, no. God is like, I gave that to you. I was generous with you. Now I want you to be generous with others. Now, if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, here's what the Bible says in James chapter 2, verse 14, New Living Translation again. What good is it, dear brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but don't show it? Don't show it by your actions. Can that kind of faith save anyone? Suppose you see a brother or sister who has no food or clothing, and you say, goodbye, have a good day. Stay warm, eat well, but then you don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, faith by itself isn't enough. Unless it produces good deeds, it is dead and useless. Paul in Romans chapter 12, verse 13 says the same thing, but in different words. When God's people are in need, be ready to help them. Always be eager to practice hospitality. If you are a Christ follower and you have been blessed with earthly resources, the word of God to you is to be generous with what you have. To be generous with what you have. No, lest you think that we should only give to the household of faith, lest you think we should only give to those who are believers, here's what Isaiah 58 verse 7 says, share your food with the hungry, give shelter to the homeless, give clothes to those who need them, and do not hide from relatives who need your help. I love that part. That's why I love the New Living Translation. Because you know what? Some people, and I heard this phrase when I came to TCI, some people get rich and they switch. You know what that means? They were poor, and when they were poor, they were playing with you, and they were your boy, and they were hanging out with you. But the minute they start to get some money, guess what? Oh, I done. All right, don't come to my home. I stop hanging. I stop liming. I'm stop fraternizing. I'm not doing anything with you again. I've suddenly forgotten family. I want to tell you something that happened at our elders' meeting this year. Sorry, not this year, this month, January. We had an elders' meeting, and we were talking about benevolence and generosity and everything. And I've never given the full picture here at Harvest as to how much we give, but by the generosity of God's people, people who attend here, people who are friends of Harvest, we have been able to bless so many people. And we don't make a big issue of it. We feel that in our heart, our conviction is that we're just going to do it, right? And we had an elders meeting, and we were just kind of looking over all the different stuff that we were doing. And one of our elders said, I think, I'm not quoting him exactly, but this was the essence of what he's saying. When we were kind of looking at everything, he said that, you know, we have slowed down in our generosity. Could you imagine that? After giving all that we have given, this godly man said, I think we have slowed down in our generosity. And he was reminding the rest of us, let's keep our foot to the pedal. Let's keep our foot on the accelerator, going forward in being generous to help those who are in need. I love being a part of a church like that, and I pray that you do, and I pray whether you go to Harvest or not, that that your church is a generous church. Now, you've heard me talk about generosity and giving, and you're probably thinking, there's a voice in the back of your mind saying this, but what about the lazy person? What about the person who just wants to feed off you? What about the parasite? Okay. Here's what Paul says to a bunch of Christians in Thessalonica. This is 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10. Here's what Paul says. Those unwilling to work will not get to eat. Ouch. Paul ain't cutting words at all. He is dropping it as it is. He says, listen, if you could work, but you are not working, then you're not going to eat. If you could work and there is work and you are not working, then you're not going to eat. He goes on in verse 11. Yet we hear that some of you are living idle lives, refusing to work, and instead meddling in other people's business. We command such people and urge them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and work to earn their own living. When last you heard a sermon like that? When last you heard a preacher, myself including, say to the people, I command you in the name of Jesus to stop gossiping and stop meddling in people's business and go to work. That's basically what Paul is saying. He's saying, if you are lazy, if there's work to be done and you are not doing it, then you won't eat. The church is not going to be generous if you are lazy. But then, to get the right balance, in verse 13, Paul goes on and he says this. As for the rest of you, those who are working, those who have it, as for the rest of you, dear brothers and sisters, never get tired of doing good. You see that? It's amazing. Paul is saying to one group, the slouches, the parasites, listen, I command you in Jesus' name to get up and work. But he's saying to the other group, those who have it, he's saying, don't be weary in doing good. That's why I love scripture, because of the balance and the wisdom it brings. God provides for us by providing the means for us to earn a living. So your job is a means for you to earn a living. But God also provides for us through the generosity of others. Now, here's the third one. And I hope you are sitting. Get ready for this. Though God provides, troubles still come. I haven't gone off my rocker, so let me say it again. Though God provides, troubles still come. Look at verse 30. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Do you see that? Though God clothes the grass, they die. They're in the oven. We are not to worry, but we are to trust in God's provision. We are to trust in God's generosity. However, God's goodness, God's provision, God's generosity does not mean that troubles will not come our way. Look at what James chapter 1 verse 2 says. Again, this is the New Living Translation. Dear brothers and sisters, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for great joy. For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow. For when your endurance is fully developed, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. What a good word for us to hear. When troubles come your way, it is an opportunity for your faith to grow. It's an opportunity for your endurance to grow. And when your faith has grown, and when your endurance has grown, here's what James says, you will be perfect and complete, needing nothing. Troubles may come, but troubles are only going to provide you with an opportunity to grow in your faith. So don't think that because you have troubles of any sort, that it means God God is turning away from you, or God hates you, or for some way God has stopped providing, or he's unable to provide. Troubles are coming as an opportunity to build your faith. But trouble also comes as an opportunity for us to do more than build our faith. Look at what Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 says. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace. I want to say something about peace before I go here. It is probably one of the scarcest commodities in our world right now. Peace. Peace that passes understanding. As Paul goes on to say, a peace which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And as scarce as peace is, Paul says this, the Holy Spirit says this, you can get it. If you stop worrying about stuff and start praying, start bringing everything to God in prayer. When you do that, your heart is going to be filled with peace. It's going to be filled with peace. But Paul goes on, and he goes to one of the most misused and misapplied verse in Scripture. People have it on their shoes. People tattoo themselves with it. But listen to Paul's words in response to the fact that he was experiencing lack. So, Philippians 4, verse 12. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. And he goes on, I have learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little. Do you want to know the secret? Do you want to know the secret, loved one? What is the secret of living a contented life? What is the secret of living with plenty or with little? Here's the secret. Listening, come close, listening. Verse 13, for I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength. You see, that verse, verse 13, was not originally meant that you can shoot a basketball into a hoop. It wasn't originally meant that you could run faster than anybody else. It wasn't originally meant that you can stand up and give a speech that will get people to give you money for your business idea. It may mean those things. It may be applied, but that wasn't its original content. Its original context was this. Paul was saying, I know how to have, and I know how to not have. I know how to be contented. With God, I can live contented. With God, I could go to sleep with a full stomach and say, praise God. And with God, I could go to sleep with an empty stomach and say, praise God. I don't need to worry. God is going to give me peace. So troubles will come, but they can bring greater faith. Troubles will come, but they can bring peace and contentment. We don't need to worry. We don't need to worry about anything. We don't need to worry about future troubles. Someone once said to worry about future troubles is to double your worry. If we have all that we need, then we can praise God. But if we don't have what we need for daily living, then we can go to God and we can say, Father, I need this. Father, I need it. And I've lived at times when I had all that I needed. And then there have been times when I had none. But God's peace and God's grace was more than sufficient. And if you are listening right now and your cupboards are empty, so empty that you can go and when you speak into your cupboard, there's an echo that comes back. If your cupboard is so empty, I want to say this to you. Have peace, speak to God, trust God to provide, and let this be an opportunity to grow in faith, in peace, and in contentment, among other things. So beat anxiety by looking towards the amazing generosity of our Father. And the other thing is this, to be free from anxiety, look at God's plan for your life. In verse 27, Jesus says, and which of you by being anxious can add a single hour to his span of life? And then in verse 34, he says this, do not be anxious about tomorrow, For tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. The point here is that if you follow God, if you follow Jesus, then your life is not in your hands. Your life is in the hands of God. He has designed your life. He knows when it started. He was right there. And he knows when it will end. He knows each and every one of your steps. There's nothing about your life that is hidden from God. Now, look at Psalm 139 from verse 1. I'm going to read it in the New Living Translation again, because this says it much better than anything I could say. Psalm 139, verse 1. Please write that down, and you can always look it up after. But here's what God says. O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my thoughts, even when I am far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord. You go before me and follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the farthest oceans, even there, your hand will guide me and your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night. But even in darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you, the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. Wow. What an amazing text. And as the psalmist was praying to God, he was confirming what is true, that God knows our life. He was there before we were born. He knows every step that we have taken so far. He knows every step that we will take, and he will be right there at the end of life. Now, what I'm going to say is based on what we just read in Matthew 6, 27 and 34, and Psalm 139 and some other places. Since God knows your life inside out, there's no one who is better at planning your life than God. You can have freedom from anxiety, listen to this, by abandoning your plans for your life and instead following God's plans. I'm going to say it again because it may have gotten stuck somewhere, right? Abandon your plans for your life and instead follow God's plans for your life, because he knows you. And he knows life. And Proverbs 3:6, Proverbs 3:6 says this: seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Now, this is what it means to see God's will for your life. Ready for a definition? Here goes. Frequently consult with and inquire of him so as to follow what he says. This is what it means to seek the will of God. Frequently consult with and inquire of him so as to follow what he says. This means for every decision of life, pray about it. Pray about it. That is what it means to consult with God. It means to talk to him. He wants to communicate with you, and he has already done that. Nature declares the glory of God. The scriptures speak of God's goodness. Jesus Christ communicates to us. God wants to speak to us. God is always speaking to us. So talk to him. Tell him about the plans that you are thinking. Tell him about the dreams that you have. So pray about it. Then do this. Talk to wise, godly people, because sometimes God speaks to us through other people. So when you pray and talk to him and you read scripture and he talks to you, sometimes you need to talk to others because they can communicate to you God's words in a way that brings clarity. But to see God's will further, this is what you have to do. You have to search the scriptures for what God says on that issue. You have to search the scriptures for the principles that God has there. But I believe that you can pray and you can counsel with others and you can search the scriptures, but you have to do this part. You have to do this one. You have to commit to doing what is clearly revealed to you. Because I know a lot of people, myself included in the past, have done this. We have prayed about an issue. We have spoken to others about it. We have searched the scriptures. And then when God says, do X, we do B. When God says, I want you to take this step, we say no, and we go back. We have to commit to doing what is clearly revealed to us. Now, I remember as a family, my wife and I were once faced with a choice whether or not to take a large loan to make a purchase. Now, while the idea of debt is for another discussion, we prayed about it. We searched the scriptures. We talked to other people. We looked at the principles of debt and generosity. We prayed again, and we fasted. And then at that time, we felt clearly that God was saying, do not take on this debt. So we did that. We decided against taking out a loan of that size. And I want to say this, loved one, that was a great decision. Because looking back now on that decision, we have seen how right that was. Because God wanted to do some things in our lives, then and now, and God wanted to take us in a particular direction, that if we had this thing around our neck, if we had this debt around our neck, we would not have been able to do it in the way that God wanted. So loved ones, when you know that God is your Father, and when you have the perspective that he loves you, that he's on your side, trust him with all the decisions of your life. Take them to him in prayer. Listen to what he says to you. Consult with godly people. Search scripture and commit to doing whatever he says to you. And stop being anxious about your life. Stop being anxious about your future. Now here's the third thing I want you to write down. To be free from anxiety, seek God. Seek God. Look at verse 33. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. As Sinclair Ferguson said this, the chief drive in our lives should be to live under the authority of the king and to see his kingdom extended in every possible way, morally, socially, and geographically, as well as personally, inwardly, and spiritually. Anxiety ends and contentment begins at the place where God is in charge of your life and you are living according to his rules. Life in the kingdom of God is an anxiety-free zone. And if you have not done so, if you have been tracking with us for this, for these four messages, I want to encourage you to do this now. Commit to giving God charge of your life and commit to living a holy life, a life that is filled with integrity. Now, this is what it means to see God's kingdom and God's righteousness. It means to have God's rule over your life, and it means to follow God's rules for life. Over the last 4 weeks, we have tackled the sinful disease of anxiety. We have learned that God provides everything for defeating anxiety in our life. You don't have to live under its shadow anymore. You don't have to obey anxiety anymore. And I pray that you listen to these messages over and over. And I pray that as you do that, that the Spirit of God will speak to you and you will be delivered from the sinful disease that is anxiety. And I do thank God for what he has done. And I do at the same time want to tell you this, for the next several weeks, God's willing, we are going to go through Matthew chapter 7. And there are a number of wonderful, pertinent things there for us. Because we're going to be teaching about relationships, we're going to be teaching about choices, we're going to be teaching about prayer. And I would love you to commit to being a part of these messages. And also to inviting a friend or sharing this with a friend. Remember this. Don't worry. Seek God. Loved one, listen to me. Don't worry. Seek God. You give it to God. Don't worry. 2021, don't worry about anything. Trust God. Give it to him. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. The word is good. I pray that it was clear. And I pray that your spirit will take this word and what we have said before and that it would bring life transformation in the hearts and the lives of those who have heard. Father, do your thing more than I could ever think, more than I could ever imagine. Do your thing with this word. And I pray for that person who's now experiencing freedom from anxiety, and I thank you for them. And I pray for that person that is still suffering from anxiety. Anxiety that has come from just thinking about life and the future. I pray that your message, your word, will penetrate the fog that is surrounding them right now. That they would get clarity. They would get understanding. Their eyes would be open. Their hearts would be open. And they would step out of anxiety and they would step into peace and freedom. Father, do it. Do it, Father. Do it because of your love. Do it because of your word. Do it because of Jesus. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. You are loved. Have a great day, guys.